you can or cannot do.
Okay, so basically the talk would be outlining the background when we consider a switch, some important points of time that we have to define, and what do you mean by the switch and what do you mean by the ad. We'll go to AMD. So all the discussions have been about switching or switching between drugs, that is switching between ranibizumab and bevacizumab, was not really a great point because they're two very similar agents. The question of switching has really come into force now when aflibercept has been introduced into the market. And also it's pretty interesting to know that PDT, which came, went, and is now, it really has an important role in, especially in Asian scenario. So the first point is to define what do you mean by unresponsive treatment. There are many definitions. That is, there are some definitions that go that after 3 injections, you call it unresponsive, 6 injections, studies that say 8 to 9 injections. But one point I'd like to say, you cannot define responsiveness unless you have treated the patient properly in the prescribed drug window. If you give the drug in 4 to 5, if you give the drug one drug now and one drug after 7 weeks, and then you say it is not responding after 3 injections, you have gone against the protocol. So that is not something you can define unresponsiveness with. 3 important terms. What is tachyphylaxis, tolerance, and true non-response? Tachyphylaxis is a phenomenon by which with each injection you give, it is a long-term phenomenon. With each injection you give, it's a short-term phenomenon. You give it and it loses its potency. Then you withdraw the drug for some time and give it again, it is potent again. Tolerance is a long-term effect. With increasing drug doses, it just suddenly loses to respond. And when you call it a true non-response, it is not a myth. There is something called true non-response. It means that it hasn't responded from the first dose you have given. Again, you can define these topics only if you are sure that you have given the patient the proper drug in the proper time and that you know that you're giving the proper schedule. So tachyphylaxis is an immunological phenomenon. You have neutralizing antibodies against the anti-VEGF. There is circulating anti-VEGF, there is an upregulation, there is more anti-VEGF circulating, but the anti-VEGF, the VEGF receptors are not blocked. Tolerance is essentially due to 2 reasons. One, there is a long, the fluid causes sufficient damage and causes photoreceptor atrophy and the edema doesn't go away, or there is a maturation of the membranes, a loss of the new vessel component on which the anti-VEGF acts, or there is enough fibrosis around the membrane or the scar so that the diffusion of the anti-VEGF into that level doesn't happen. So it is a more permanent thing without an immediate solution. True non-tolerance is a couple of parts. There is something called VEGF polymorphism. Everybody doesn't have the same receptors to VEGF. So you may not respond to VEGF. Person A may not respond like person B does. You could have an inflammatory cause of neovascularization that doesn't respond to anti-VEGF, or you could have vitreo macular traction. 3 very important causes of non-response. So what happens in CNVM, treatment, everything keeps on working till, one, you have an upregulation and there's more circulating VEGF. You have maturation of the membrane or fibrosis, as I said, structural changes. Or you have barriers to the diffusion of the drug. So, and then what happens? Then you think of switching. So does it make sense to switch between ranibizumab and bevacizumab? I would like to say that all the studies till last year or year before last said that there are equal number of studies saying it is useless and equal number of studies saying it is highly effective. On a pure scientific basis, it's very hard to say that how it could be effective because both drugs are really very similar. So, and most of the changes of switching are, as you know, finance driven. In real life, when you have a reduced response, you have to make sure, as I said, that there is adherence to, there is proper adherence to the protocol. Has the patient been given drugs on a 4-weekly interval? Can you establish that there was a diminished response? You can ask for a drug holiday, stop the drug for 2 weeks or 2 months and see if the response comes again to differentiate between tachyphylaxis and tolerance. You can try switching to an anti-VEGF, another anti-VEGF, and you have to rule out some mandatory causes like PCV or RAP to make sure that these are not the reasons why your anti-VEGF is not working. So these are the techniques. You have a drug holiday, to see after the drug holiday, does the anti-VEGF work? You can switch between the two drugs. We're just talking about bevacizumab and ranibizumab now. You can reduce the drug frequency. I know there are a lot of places, especially in Europe, that change it from 4 weekly intervals to 3 weekly intervals. I truly, honestly do not see any logic behind it, but or increasing the drug dose from 1.25 milligrams to 2.5 milligrams if it's bevacizumab. But the most important thing I'm saying again, check whether the schedule for follow-up and treatment has been maintained. But I believe the true switch is switching towards aflibercept. There is a logic. One, it is a 100-fold better blocker of anti-VEGF-A than ranibizumab, okay? But it also blocks other anti-VEGFs, anti-VEGF-B and placental growth factor, okay? Why do we assume that all the problems in the eye are due to only anti-VEGF? That is a concept all of us have to get in our minds. There are still unknown vasculogenic modulators, mediators that we are not thinking of when we treat. It is a less immunogenic drug than the other two. It takes care of the circulating VEGF. It's a VEGF trap. It takes care of the circulating VEGF. Means once there is an upregulation, there's a lot of VEGF around. It binds to that. So you have three very valid points, which tell you that if you switch an anti-VEGF, it is better to switch to aflibercept rather than between ranibizumab and bevacizumab. Now, it is important to identify PCV as a cause of failure of your anti-VEGF or recurrence of your anti-VEGF. And it is important to look at RAP also as a cause, retinal angiomatosis, because the response to anti-VEGF is definitely dissimilar in your regular CNVM or AMD as in RAP. So the logic says that the switch to between ranibizumab and bevacizumab may be finance-driven rather than anything else. The switch to aflibercept is more scientific. You need to add PDT in a scenario where you have diagnosed PCV, and when you define diminishing response, you have to actually give the drug continuously for 2 or 3 times to make sure it is a diminished response or not a non-adherence to protocol. We'll just go to DME quickly also. We've all seen this. I absolutely do not want to look at tables. This is a typical table all of us use for presentations. This is important. Mean number of injections, 8 to 9 monthly. So again, in DME, the requirement to adhere to protocol is very, very important. So this is something that not a lot of us really know. That is when to start, when to stop. This is a simplified DRCR network thing. So if you have improvement, you continue injecting after a month and watch. If you do not have improvement, you withhold for a month. This is a simplified DRCR network study. And if you have improvement, you can continue injecting. If you do not have improvement, you can wait and watch and observe for a month. And if there is no improvement, you can double the follow-up period. You have to decide either it has to improve 6/6 vision or no further improvement or OCT, or it's getting worsening. So in DME, the switch is basically switch to steroids or switch to other anti-VEGFs, or the ad is adding micropulse laser. This I would say is the current concept now. So it is well known that a fifth of patients, 20% patients, do not respond to anti-VEGF properly. And the OCT, when they respond, a clue is that the OCT gets better and then the vision gets better after that. So I'm just going to skip a few, and we'll just talk about protocol I, which compared all of these things. And protocol I is the one that put down steroids very badly. But if you look at protocol I subsets, it said that in pseudophakic patients, triamcinolone worked, one. It also said that in a subgroup of patients where the visual loss was severe, triamcinolone was better. So steroids do seem to have a role. And the recommendations were that if the starting visual acuity is low or the patient is pseudophakic, you can try steroids instead of anti-VEGF. That was a recommendation years ago from the protocol I. But the universal truth is simple. There are non-anti-VEGF driven mechanisms in DME, inflammatory mechanisms happening. Two, there is VEGF polymorphism. Everybody does not respond to VEGF the same. And I talked to you about the inflammation. Another thing is defining DME. There is an entity called chronic DME, which you define after 3 injections, sometimes 6 injections, 3 months. What is the opposite of chronic DME? It is not acute DME, it is non-chronic DME. So that is a division. A non-chronic DME is a DME that is acute, it responds to anti-VEGF. A chronic DME is something that fails to respond over time. And the treatment is different. The current concept is that the acute forms of DME are anti-VEGF driven, while later in the disease it becomes more anti-inflammatory mediator driven. The second is a type of response. I might take a few seconds extra. You have four types of response to anti-VEGF: an early consistent, early inconsistent, a slow variable, and you have a non-responder. So if you fall in the slow variable response or an early inconsistent response and you stop the anti-VEGF treatment earlier without assessing which type of response, you're stuck at a period where you don't know whether your drug is working or not. It is important to diagnose these types of responders to say, okay, who do I shift over to a steroid earlier? So we've just, based on that, we assess there are three types of people. One type of group of people is a VEGF-driven response, one is a VEGF-independent response, and one is a partial VEGF-driven response. For the independent and the partial-driven response, steroids, adding steroids makes a lot of sense. So the last is to, I'd like to summarize this by saying that in a patient, before switching or adding steroids, you have to think of defining, does a patient have a chronic DME? Have you proved that to anti-VEGF the patient has suboptimal responses? Have you proved adherence to a proper schedule in a vitrectomized eye or refractory to multiple treatment patients? The next ad we're talking about is micropulse. I'm not going to go a lot into it. Please don't cut me off. Two more seconds. Add a micropulse to it, which is very, the effect of micropulse is actually quite spectacular. So a combination treatment using anti-VEGF, steroids, and micropulse, and most important, in a custom, a tailor-made fashion for each patient, is probably going to be the way out. So I'd like to thank you for your patient listening. Thank you.
Wonderful talk, Unnikrishnan.